child, there's no need to cry. Stand up on your feet now, lift your head up high. Don't wait till tomorrow to lay down your sorrow. Freedom is here today. Wipe away those tears, child. Put down your shame. Oh, I see an empty grave. I hear the heavens waking, angels in jubilation. Dead stones been rolled away. I feel the darkness breaking. I bet the devil shaking. Somebody say.
Good morning. It's good to see everybody. I hope everybody's doing well. Under the circumstances, we're still in some uncertain times. We're following the guidelines of the government, trying our best to get everything open and running again. We do appreciate your patience with us. I want to thank all of you for tuning in on YouTube and on Facebook. I want to give a shout out to my chief engineer, Emma, making sure that the music and the video and everything goes according to plan. And also to Brother Billy for getting everything transitioned over to Facebook and to YouTube. Again, we want to make sure you know that you can mail your tithes and offerings to P.O. Box 38, Mount Hope, Alabama, 35651. Not a lot in the way of announcements, but we do have a lot of folks in our church family that are struggling. We've had some in our community that are grieving the passing of loved ones. We've had some that are having tests and surgeries. Some that are facing some pretty stiff sicknesses, and some that are just weak, some that are very tired. And I'm going to ask you and encourage you, call and check on each other. If you know of anybody that's got a need, let me know. I'm going to ask you to join me in prayer, and then we'll see what God has for us in His Word. Father, I do thank You so much, Lord, that there is an empty grave. That, Father, You're now seated at the right hand of the Father, Lord, making intercession for us. God, thank You so much for giving us the technology, Lord, to be able to broadcast our message, to minister not just to our church family, but to our community, to our state, and for those all the way around the world, Lord. God, thank You for giving us this. And God, I just pray for those that are sick and those that are hurting and those that are just broken, that, God, You would be everything to them, Lord. Be that comfort, be that friend, be that guide. Use us as the hands and feet of Jesus, Lord, to reach out to each other, God, to minister to each other. Father, I just pray over your word, Lord, that it speaks, and it speaks loud, and it speaks clear, and that it is that sharp two-edged sword, Lord, and it pierces right to the soul, dividing of the sunder, Lord, right at the heart of the matter. God, speak to us. God, give us something that we can use. Change us. Move us. Lord, stir us. God, I thank you now for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to talk to you about a message that I've brought before. Wasn't real sure about doing my Wednesday night out of Proverbs, and somebody called me after it was over, and they said that they really enjoyed it and they really needed it and it was really applicable to their life. And I've just had this message on my heart, so I'm going to bring it, trusting in the Lord that somebody needs to hear this. And I'm going to talk to you about how to get out of trouble. And it seems like we're troubled on every side, pushed and pressed and tossed and turned. You know, and it's all because we have that sin in our life, that sin nature that brought in that fights against us. And Job said in 14:1, a man who is born of a woman is of a few days and full of trouble. And my heart's desire is that as we go through this message this morning, if you're in trouble, if you're facing one of these two scenarios, I'm going to ask you to just get down on your knees and just pray. I'm going to ask you to just pray, God, just show me the way out. I know you're there and I know you hear me. There's two ways that we can get into trouble with sin. The first way, is you get into trouble because of the sin in your life. And I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles and turn to the book of John, chapter 8. John, chapter 8 has Jesus on the Mount of Olives. And he's there and he's speaking to the crowd, and as usual, he's trying to teach and he's trying to do miracles and he's being pressed on every side. But something unusual happens. John chapter 8, starting in verse 2. The Bible says, early in the morning, he came again to the temple and all the people came unto him and he sat down and he taught them. The scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground. Now you just imagine the chaotic scene. Jesus is trying to teach. They bring this woman. They throw her in the midst. They start making accusations. And what does Jesus do? He stoops down on the ground and he starts doodling with his finger. Now there are a lot of things that could be attributed to why he's doing this. Is he labeling the sins of those others? Is he writing out the things that they've done in their life? But a few things we need to ask ourselves about this adulterous woman. Do you think that this was her first act of adultery? Do you think that the Pharisees that brought her were her friends or her enemies? You ever had those people in your life that say, hey, you know, I want to be your friend, and they want to hug you, but they want to stick that knife in? Sometimes, you know, we're falsely accused to make the story sound that much better, because everybody likes a great story, and sometimes embellishment makes it sell. Just look at the news if you don't believe that. Where was the man in this story? Moses commanded that both be stoned, not just the woman. And it was illegal for the Jews to pass judgment on others under Roman law. So this was not only a trap for the woman, it was also a trap for Jesus. Can't you see Satan working, Satan, that great accusers? Let me ask you this. What sins do we commit in secret? Numbers 32:23 says, and be sure your sins will find you out. What happens when someone sees our secret sinful life? Is it embarrassing? When this woman was found out, she was dragged to the temple. Just imagine, she was caught in the very act. She was probably naked, thrown right in the midst of those men. Do you think she was embarrassed? Put yourself in her shoes. You get into trouble because of sin in your life. And number two, you get into trouble because of the sin in opposition to your life. So take your Bibles and turn with me to Acts chapter 16. You can put your little fly out right there, your little label in your Bible. And turn with me to Acts chapter 16. Sometimes it's because of the things that we've done in our life, and sometimes it's just Satan trying to stop our forward progress. In Acts chapter 16, we see Paul and Silas. And in verse 16 of chapter 16, the Bible says, "It came to pass as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, These men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus to come out of her. And he came out that same hour. And when her masters saw the hope of their gains were gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace under the rulers and brought them to the magistrates, saying, These men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks." Now, let's stop right there. Now, just imagine, if you will, the scene. Paul and Silas are walking, and there's this girl that has this divination of a spirit, and she keeps saying, "These are the servants of the Most High God." She was a slave, and she was captured, and she brought great money to her masters because they were able to use her to prophesy. And Paul, like many of us, have had all he can take, turn and cast this demon out. Do you think Paul did wrong by healing this little slave girl? Ephesians 4:26 says, "Be angry and sin not." Yet have you ever done the right thing and felt punished or ridiculed because of it? 2 Corinthians 12:10, Paul says, "Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong." But do we really know what persecution is? It might be that your idea of persecution is going up the Coke machine and putting your money in, and it gives you something diet when you don't want something diet, or it gives you something regular when you wanted something diet. In verse 19, it says, "Paul and Silas were dragged to the rulers." Now, I'm sure they were not carefully dragged. I'm sure it was carelessly dragged, just kicking and screaming, just in their clothes, in verse 22, being literally ripped off their bodies. Now, they weren't wearing tearaway jerseys like they wear in sports nowadays. They were ripped of their clothes and beat much more than required. You remember in Deuteronomy 25:3, Moses' law stated only 40 lashes could be laid because more would be humiliation to your brother. But the Romans had no limit. They had no care. Just like when Jesus was beaten, Paul and Silas truly suffered for Christ. Satan also tried to snuff out their ministries, just like he tried to snuff out Jesus. Have you ever suffered for Christ? Maybe we're facing trouble because of the sin in our life. Are we facing trouble because of the sin in opposition to our life? Now let's look at how are we delivered. How are we delivered, number one, from sin against your life? Go with me back to Acts chapter 16. Picking up in verse 24, we read that just prior. We're going to read it again. It says, "Who, having received such a charge, the jailer thrust them into prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed." Now you just imagine Paul and Silas taken to the inner room of the prison. They weren't in the outer walls. They were all the way down in the middle because they were considered the greatest flight risk. They were bloody, they were battered, they were locked in leg irons, and they had rusty chains on them, and they were sitting there, and what did they do? Did they have a pity party? Did they say, oh, woe is me, how did I end up here? The Bible says they sang praises. They called out to Jesus. Can you just imagine the songs that Paul and Silas were singing? What is the song that brings comfort to you? A lot of times when I'm out and I'm working, I'll start singing, what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. Just imagine them singing and shouting and boldly praying out loud to a holy God. How many of us have enough spirit about us to do that no matter what comes our way? How many of us think to praise God in times of trouble? They reached out like in Mark 5, the woman when Jesus was on the way to see Jairus, the synagogue ruler, when he was on the way to heal her daughter, that woman reached out and just grabbed just the very edge of the garment. That was all it took to radically change her, to radically heal her. They remembered the promise that Jesus made of an easy yoke and a light burden in Matthew 11:29. They had drank of the living water in John 4:14, where Jesus said, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. And they remembered Jesus' promise in Mark 4:35 when he got in the boat and he said, let us cross over to the other side. I did not come to drown. I did not come to get beat to death. I came to give my life for you. Now, how many times when we're facing trouble because of the sin against our life do we think to praise Jesus Christ? Maybe it's not the sin against us. Maybe number two, it's the sin in our life. Let's go back to John chapter 8. Back to the story of the adulterous woman. John chapter 8. We'll pick up in verse 7. They drugged this woman in. They threw her in front of Jesus. Said, we caught her right in the act. Moses said, stone her, what do you say do? And Jesus has squatted down and he's doodling in the sand. The Bible says, so when they continue asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, he that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground, and they which heard it being convicted by their own conscience went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus lifted himself up and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, woman, where are those thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Then spake Jesus unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. What do you think that woman did while the Pharisees were annoying and testing Jesus? She was there naked, exposed, shamed, embarrassed, and all alone. You ever been there? You ever been laid bare all by yourself? Nobody to stand up for you? You're in the boardroom and you're answering those questions, or you're in the doctor's office and you're having to make those decisions, or everybody's talking about you or saying things about you. Have you ever been there? Do you think she begged for mercy? Do you think she prayed for forgiveness right then and there? She may have even wondered, how did I end up here? They say sin takes you further than you want to go, costs you more than you want to pay, and keeps you longer than you ever intended to stay. She might have been like a prodigal daughter, like the prodigal son over in Mark chapter 15, and just strayed to a far-off land and found herself in this situation. I think she called out to Jesus. I think she realized what John 14:6 means when Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. I believe so because she says, no man, Lord. In verse 11, how did she know Jesus was Lord? I believe she had a salvation experience right there. I believe she came face to face with an almighty God. And when he said, go and sin no more, I don't condemn you, I believe she had a life-changing experience. What do you think their life was like after these circumstances? You look at Paul and Silas. You look at this adulterous woman. What do you think their life was like afterwards? This adulterous woman was told to go and sin no more. Paul and Silas were set free. When you think about the encounter of sin against their life with Paul and Silas, they didn't instantly heal. They still had bloody wounds and they would carry scars for the rest of their life. Now, why do you think God created scars? You remember the story in John chapter 9 where the blind man received sight? They said, Jesus, who sinned to cause this man to be born? Was it his parents or was it him? And Jesus said it was neither. It was so that the Son of Man would be glorified. I believe by the power of the Son of the living God, they were set free indeed. John 10:28-29 says, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. Ephesians 6:12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. When you gave your life to Jesus, did you think your life was just going to be a bed of roses? Wouldn't it be something if we just gave our life to Jesus and we were called to glory right then and there? That's not how it works, is it? We're put here for a reason. We're put here so that others can see God get glory in our life. And number two, we see the cleansing of sin in her life. Did the adulterous woman instantly leave her situation? She was standing there still naked. She was probably still being laughed at. She had that long, embarrassing walk back home. She had to go back to the home that she was dragged out of. I wonder when she got back, were there men standing there waiting on her? Did she say, my life has changed totally? You know, I remember a story told about a lady that was a dancer in a nightclub. And some ladies came in and witnessed to her. She actually owned the place, and they witnessed to her in the background, behind the stage, and she said, as I was praying to receive Jesus Christ, I could feel the ground moving from the bass that was playing. She said, I might have got down on my knees a tramp, but I got up a lady. I got up a child of God. And she said, I went and turned the lights on, turned the music off, and said, we're done. It's over. I'm changed. I am not going to tolerate this anymore. And one of the guys, one of the regulars, she ended up leading him to the Lord, and they got married, and they've got one of the greatest, most awesomest ministries today. That's what happens when God changes you. She left Jesus with no condemnation. She left free, just like Paul and Silas in John 8:32. Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Do you know the truth? Do you know Jesus? Nobody comes in contact with Jesus and sees the real Him and does not leave changed. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Just like the prodigal son in Mark chapter 15, you have to come home just like you are and let the Father clean you up. I encourage you to go and read that story. That young man was out living the good life and spending the money and going through his friends, and when it was all gone, he was filling himself with the husks that the swines would not eat. The Bible says he came to himself and he went home to the Father. The Bible doesn't say he took a shower. The Bible doesn't say he brushed his teeth. The Bible doesn't say he combed his hair. The Bible says he went home just like he was and let the Father clean him up. Let the Father clothe him in the robe of righteousness. Let the Father put the shoes on his feet to show he was not a slave. And let the Father put the ring on his finger to show that he was bought with a price. What trouble are you in today? Are you worried about tomorrow? Are you worried about eternity? Are you facing a situation that you don't know how to handle? Is it because of the sin in your life? Or is it because of the sin against your life? We need to call out to God. I'm going to ask him to play a hymn of invitation. We're going to get down on our knees and we're going to pray and do some business with God.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your grace and for your mercy, Lord, and for being able to just run to you, Lord. Father, just fall at your feet, God, and just carry our burdens to you. Father, I pray for our brothers and sisters, Lord, that are hurting, those that are really struggling. Father, those that are facing decisions, God, I pray that your grace is sufficient, that you just cover them, Lord, and let them know that you've never left them nor forsook them, Lord. God, help us to be your hands and feet as we reach out and take care of each other. God, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for tuning in. I appreciate it. And I ask that you hit that like and subscribe button. And thank you so much for your comments. I love you, and I look forward to seeing you.